Thank you for joining me in the MPP Power Hour. I am your host, Massimo Palermo. Today, I have with me as my guest, Gina Linnell Schaefer. Gina was born in Lafayette, Louisiana, and grew up in Texas. Gina went to the University of Houston and gained a degree in psychology and a minor in history. Gina is a mother to her amazing son, and she is a writer of multiple novels. And when she's not teaching or writing, she entertains herself with paranormal investigations and traveling to haunted sites. Now, without further ado, I would like to welcome to my show Gina Linnell Schaefer. Hello, Gina. Welcome to the MPP Power Hour.
Hello. It's a pleasure to be here today. I'm glad to have me on.
Thank you for joining us. So Gina, as I kind of shared with the audience there, you're a writer. Why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself to everybody, and then we'll take it from there.
Well, if you like paranormal horror or thrillers, I'm your girl, because that's where it's all based around. There's all a bunch of spirituality that's wrapped up in between. I currently have 5 books out, currently writing my 6th, but that will be out probably sometime next year. And the places that are in the book, even though it's all fiction, the places in the book that actually do exist, for example, as we were talking about, Tenny Hall, Texas is a real place. So is Jefferson and Carthage and Crockett and all the other places that are mentioned in the book. It just has a very paranormal twang that's woven around it. And Tenny Hall is the heart of the story.
And I am sharing your latest book.
Yes. So
speaking of Tenaha, The Possession. So there are some events that also occurred in the book as well. In the city of Tenaha, you're saying?
Yeah, the first book, Tenaha, it started off, and that is actually about a mute autistic teen that has the ability to see spirits, and she witnesses a murder, and the ghost around her help her, and she gets a friend of hers who is also has Asperger's, and a group of people along with her uncle that helps her recover the body of the person that was murdered. And there's all these little intricate things that happen. She's the daughter of a pastor, and the church was going downhill. So what he brought in snake handling, which was something that absolutely terrified her. I had such good reviews with the first book, and people that had read it, I was getting emails from strangers saying, you've got to write a sequel. So I wrote a sequel. It does have the same characters. However, it could stand alone. In fact, I got an email just yesterday saying, I think I like the sequel even better. And it's the heart of it is at Tenny Hall, but it's of course teenagers, and I had to bring in our times. So their coven like meets on the internet in a chat room, and they are at 5 different points that are around Tenny Hall where they commit these vicious crimes in hopes to gain some. They feel like that by committing these crimes and making these sacrifices that they'll gain prestige and wealth. And the points each around it actually forms a pentagram around Tenny Hall, and it's the heart of the story. Fortunately, though, the same characters are still in there. They catch wind. And I added a few angelic characters in there as well to help guide these people and able to believe in themselves, not so much to solve the crimes, but to help them to believe in themselves and let them know that they have in there. So you've got paranormal horror, but you've got a lot of spirituality going on, too. Good versus evil, David versus Goliath type of thing.
And adventurous, it sounds somewhat as well.
Absolutely. There's a lot of adventure in all of my books.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah, it's very interesting. The subject matter itself, paranormal, when did you start writing and I always say the genre, the story leads the genre. Did you basically just start writing and paranormal just happened to be you know?
I have always wanted to be a writer. I didn't actually start really writing, you know, seriously until my first book was released in 2019, which was Tenny Hall. But I have been into paranormal investigations all of my life, ever since I was a little girl, and I had things that happened around me that it was kind of like it found me. I didn't find them. And I began to realize that this is not a bad thing, that, you know, I've gone on investigations. Everybody, oh, something's evil's in my house. You know, all those reality shows where they say there's a demon and stuff.
Yeah.
90% of the time, that is not the case at all.
Mm-hmm.
I won't mark any shows. They're not here to defend themselves. But there's also some really good ones out there to pay attention to, because what I find on these investigations over and over again is that they're just like how they are in real life. If you've got a cranky ghost, they were probably cranky in life. If you've got a friendly ghost that's always trying to help you, that's probably what their nature was in life. Mm-hmm. And most of the time, they're stuck here because they're afraid to move on. It's not even so much of unfinished business, as you hear in all the movies, but there's a reason that they don't want to move on. They feel maybe frightened. Maybe they're concerned about some, you know, some things that they've done in their life. They're afraid of going to hell, perhaps.
Yeah.
And so, in fact, that's where the idea came from. Sharon's Last Call, another one of my books, that really talks about God's forgiveness and he wants his children with him.
So let's talk a little bit about that. You were just saying ghosts are maybe afraid, they're not ready to move on and so forth. So tell me about these ghosts. Are they people that know the persons in the house usually?
When I've gotten into investigations, not really. They observe. There's a lot of observers. Some of them want to do malice. Sometimes, just like you meet people that you don't like, sometimes there are ghosts that just don't like you for whatever reason. And you've got to take in mind, I mean, life has changed so much. If you're in a house that has a ghost that's there from the 1800s, and they come in and they see, you know, there's people that come into their home and they have all these tattoos and these weird piercings.
Yeah.
They don't understand it. We talk about the older generation not understanding it, but there are these, you know, these spirits, because time stands still for them. You know, they may not understand how these two men are deeply in love with each other, or how the, you know, why somebody is dyeing their hair pink or wearing these short skirts and low cut blouses, because it's not appropriate in their time. And so just like we have a lack of understanding, they may have a lack of understanding as well. It's just when you've got a solid person in front of you, yes, it's much easier to educate. But for them, there's that judgment in them as well. And that's just like it's human nature, it's ghostly nature too.
Got it. So, and did these ghosts usually die in that house as well?
Not necessarily. A lot of times they have been attracted to the house, or it was a place that they were fond in. But most of the time when I've gone into an investigation where it's an individual home versus just like a haunted site, they have died in the home.
Okay.
I would say that, you know, and they were just kind of a little bit afraid to let go. Perhaps they're a little bit confused. I've also been to haunted areas that were outside where ghosts were just kind of wandering around amongst the people, not necessarily understanding why they're gone, and they're trying to get their message across. I know, for example, I was doing an investigation with somebody in a particular area. It was an abandoned train house, but there was a park around there. And I get this EVP message as I'm trying to connect who's there. This other person comes in and says, Ron killed me. Ron killed me right here. And I look around, and sometimes I can see or feel the spirits, but this was not a case where that happened. But what it was this guy was murdered, and he was trying, I guess it was ruled an accident. I tried to go in and I looked at the case. I was able to find out who was killed there. I even went to the gravesite to visit the gravesite. But he just wanted somebody to know what happened to him. And then when I went a couple of times later, I noticed, you know, and I talked to him about, you know, moving on. I haven't heard from him again, even when I visited those sites. So I do believe that he moved on. But it was just the idea is he wanted somebody to know that, you know, this person killed me.
Gotcha.
There was another house that I went into, and many generations lived there. And this was actually a house in Mississippi. And I could actually see these ghosts pretty vividly, even though there were some people around there that couldn't. And it was really cool the way that they had it set up, because it was ran by so many generations. So they had ribbons that were placed on different items that these people had owned, and they were color-coded. Well, this one little girl in this one room, there was a jewelry box, and she kept trying to tell me, this is mine, this is mine. And so, and she was being a pest. And so I, you know, I was embarrassed because I was on a tour, and my husband's like, what's going on? And my son could see her too, but he couldn't. And so I was like, I got to take care of this. So I went and I I looked, and sure enough, there was a little pink bone that was behind the dresser. I put the bow onto the jewelry box. So Ghost goes, oh, I didn't even notice that. And at the end, when I turned around, I took a picture of the house. And it was really cute because her picture showed up and she was waving goodbye.
Wow.
And it was actually a really sweet picture. It's a ghost. And some people are really like, okay, that's creepy. But there was nothing creepy about it. There was just this little girl that was, and I think she was 12 or 13 when she died in childbirth, that was forced to be married to a 46-year-old man. So, I mean, her story was quite sad, but you could tell she was just very appreciative of that gesture that was taken care of. And so, you know, that's not a horror story. That's not a scary story.
Sure.
That's just a little girl that wanted to be acknowledged.
Got it. So you sound a lot like that show, if I'm not mistaken, Ghost Whisperer.
My husband, who just recently passed, he used to tease me a lot. I'm like, I just want her wardrobe. Because I love the way Linda Gordon dressed. Unfortunately, I don't see them as clear as she did. And they they don't produce themselves as clear.
Yeah.
But when they do, they can be kind of pesky. Sometimes I can hear them.
Yeah.
A lot of times they show up in my pictures though. And you know, like I'll take somebody else's camera just to say, look, I'm not using the filter. I'm not using this. And look, there they are.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if there is something I can do to help, I will. Sometimes it can be quite pesky. Sometimes it can be mean. Like this particular little girl, there was a room across the way, because like I said, this was built in many generations. And there was a ghost in there that would yell and growl at her. And I mean, if I should have taken EVPs, but I mean, I was on a day tour, so I didn't think about doing it. But I could see where somebody might hear those growls and snarls and think this was a demon. This wasn't a demon. This was just a really nasty man who he did commit a lot of crimes in his life. But it wasn't like some of those demonic experiences. I've only run into three different, in the 15 years that I've done investigations, I've only run into three different experiences where it was a distinct demonic haunting.
Not like The Exorcism, the movie. That was also based off of a true story. So
absolutely. John Doe story. They just made it a little girl. But yeah, I was very fascinated. And yeah. I've always been, because I've always, like, would see things that other people wouldn't see. It would freak me out. And for a while, you know, people would think I was crazy. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, fortunately, like, when it was my grandparents, they would tell me things that I wouldn't know. Or they would be in things that I'd seen them wear that my parents had seen them wear, and they, you know, I never would have. So they would do things to give confirmation, or even just showing up in the pictures, you know, just to give some sort of confirmation. Yes, they are there. Unfortunately, it's not as glamorous or as easy, you know, and Ghost Whisperer, I mean,
yeah,
you know, it's not going to wrap up in an hour, because it just depends on what's going on with them.
Right.
But there are some that hang around just to be a nuisance.
Right. I mean, I've had my own personal experiences in dreams where someone who I knew passed away recently that came into my dream. He wasn't talking to me, but I went back to the son and told him about it. And sure enough, he was like literally talking to me, to him, through me at that point, because my friend actually, when I told him he came, his dad came to my dream, and he was just like, wow. And yeah, so yeah, it's kind of interesting that yeah, go ahead.
Question for you. Did was it within was it before 6 months that he came and visit you within
Yeah,
that dream?
it was within a
Because
6 month period, yeah.
I did go through a mentoring period and work with like another psychic and somebody who's doesn't and sort of have the abilities, but they're great with technology and cleaning up EVPs and stuff. And they've always I've always heard that or what they tell me is that they really can't communicate with you for at least 6 months. However, I have had people come and visit me earlier than that, and there's always some sort of message. Even like my husband, who passed away June 8, he has come and visited me a couple of times in my dreams, and he's left messages. And I've had other people tell me, yes, he's left messages. And I think, you know, he's just making sure that that we're okay what's around us.
Right.
And I actually kind of I live in La Porte, Texas, and we actually live in what's a neighborhood called Battleground Estates. And the reason why it's called that is because this is where the Battle of the San Jacinto actually happened. So where all these houses are placed, all of those soldiers died. So I know sometimes like the animals will go wild. And when we first moved into this house, I would see a soldier just walking up and down our hallway. And it when you know my son was born, he would just be playing and laughing. It would be the guy messing with him. And so and then it got to the point where my husband would be like, he would see a shadow and he'd be looking around and they're like, it's okay, he means no harm. He's and I at first I just thought he was a residual haunting because he would do the same thing at the same time of day. And I know like at night the dogs would start barking around and it would look like there were things moving in the fog when there weren't things there. Even though it's a battleground, still completely safe, still completely friendly.
Sure. So tell me, when you are called on to do an investigation, have you ever gone into an investigation where there was nothing there?
Yes.
Yeah.
A lot. I mean, and I don't need to be near ugly about it because I mean, sometimes they just want something to be there. And it could also be that maybe I can't see them or I can't communicate with them. But it could be, you know, because like your dreams, relatives will stop by. They will come by and look on you. If you are smelling a smell of your great grandmother, chances are she's just peeking in just to see that you're okay. So what I always say is it's not that there wasn't something here or there's not something here. It's just not being revealed for me. I do the EVP investigations. I do a thorough, I do a thorough interview. I see what traumas happened in the life. But I have also have been in situations where it was something mechanical going on. In fact, even in my own house, my mother would refuse to be in my house because when one door would slam, when our AC would go off, or it would cause one door to shut and another door to open. She was convinced because it was me that it had to be paranormal. It wasn't. It was just one of those mechanical things. And I have seen that in homes. Sometimes it's just pipes in the walls, or just some sort of coincidence. Or if there's a train nearby, maybe it's trembling something. Not saying that they didn't experience something. I'm just saying that at the time that I'm there and I'm spending with them, I may not catch up on it. Just because I go out on an e you know, I go on an investigation and I take EVPs and I'm sensing the house and I've got dowsing rods, I've got the whole nine yards, that doesn't mean that I'm going to find something.
Right. And it could be, like you said, someone had a dream as opposed to being the site or the house or whatnot.
Exactly. And like I said, my son happened to have been born on my grandfather's birthday, who I was very close, and he was one of the spirits who would always come visit me. In fact, sometimes it makes me laugh because he kind of works as his spirit guides, and sometimes his voice actually shows up on the EVPs. When he always smoked a cigar, and so when he would come and visit my son, the house would fill with cigar smoke, and he was just popping in. He's not here to haunt. He's certainly not here to harm. Mm-hmm. He wants to see his grandson, you know, his great grandson that happened to be born on his birthday.
Gotcha. So I actually had an interesting experience way back in the day, and I've been told it was a dream, not a dream, but it was because I was falling asleep and I really didn't experience it. So I'll ask you, I was literally in bed sleeping, and all of a sudden I felt like some kind of spirit or something, like literally going to me. Like I felt like it went into inside my body, and like I couldn't move. I was like frozen, and I couldn't move. I couldn't do anything. And then after, you know, what seemed like a endless amount of time, I said something underneath my breath, and it just came back out of my body, like an out of body experience. So I was told, yeah,
it was sleep. Did they tell you it was sleep paralysis?
Yeah, I had something to that effect. Like, oh, you were just about to fall. It was a psychologist psych expert that said that. So
I can't really attest to that, but I tell you that I used to have people tell me I have sleep paralysis too. But sleep paralysis does not cause the blankets to yank off the bed, which I've had that happen.
Yeah.
So it could very well, it could be either way. Your psychologist, he may be on to something, but usually people that have sleep paralysis, for what I find, they have multiple, you know, they have multiple, and you could go like years without one, but you could have another one. Or, I mean, if you were hearing, like, cause sometimes sleep paralysis, you can hear voices and things going on. And I remember suffering from that a lot when I was very, very young. Mm-hmm. And I haven't had an episode in a while,
yeah,
but I have had episodes of that. But what gave me, this was after I was married, I was having those episodes, and my husband saw the sheets, you know, being yanked off the bed off of me, and yeah, he was like, I could see like hand marks on your, they're holding you down. Mm. So I can see, you know, there's that old hag syndrome, and perhaps there is a neurological, I'm sure there is, that causes that. But it can also, they're going to catch you when you're most vulnerable. There's ghosts all the time. You know, just, you can be haunted at 2 in the afternoon, just like you can at 2 in the morning.
Right.
It's just to catch you, and you're more alert and noticeable to it in that quiet hours when you don't have other distractions.
Sure.
I did have a situation where I was in Canton, Texas, and we were staying in a place, and this place had been burned down like 3 times. It was like a fire hazard. I'm not even sure why we were staying there. And I woke up, and, you know, Gary was like, what's wrong? Are you okay? And I was like, there's a ghost in here. She wouldn't tell me what she wanted. So I just laid it back down and went back to bed. And then I don't remember this, but apparently very shortly after that, I woke my husband up, and I was speaking in a voice. It was definitely a female voice, but it was a voice that wasn't mine.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, he got scared, of course. He asked what my name was, and gave a name. And we did some research, and there were 2 people that had died in a fire in that place 5 years before, but it wasn't the same name. And so I was like, well, I mean, maybe it was just a fluke. Maybe it was just a wandering spirit. And he's like, no, this person was very determined, and it definitely wasn't your voice. And so I did a little bit more research, and it was the name of the person that got charged for the arson. And so perhaps it was another, Ron did it, maybe it was another, Janice did this to me, trying to get that message out. And it takes a lot of energy for a spirit or ghost to be able to do something like that. Mm-hmm. And so they've got to make the most of their time when they can, especially with me, because even like the mentor that I work with, he's like, oh, we should use you for mediumship. And I'm like, oh no, I am not going to be a human Ouija board. There are people that do that, and they're very good about it. They're very good with it, but it's not something I'm willing to do. Gotcha. I'm not gonna let something enter me willingly. This person just got me because I was just absolutely excited, exhausted, and very cold, and just wanted to snuggle underneath the covers. And fortunately for me, meant me no harm. Just needed to get the message out.
Gotcha. Yeah, thankfully it only happened to me one time. It was many years ago. So, you know, it was just the weirdest feeling. Like you felt like I was being pushed. Like
a heaviness.
Yeah.
And the fact that you still remember it so clearly,
yeah,
makes me feel like that maybe it was something more, not to scare you.
Yeah.
And it could just, again, it could have just been some sort of flu.
Yeah. I was going to say, I've had psychics or whatever tell me, oh yeah, you've got like angels around you, like a lot of good angels around you, like protecting you and all that. So I'm like, oh, okay.
That's we interesting. All do.
Yeah.
We so, all do.
Yeah,
we all
yeah.
have, you know, angels that are around us.
Yep.
And I had a near-death experience several years ago, 2008, and I became even more and more aware. And so whenever I go on to an investigation, we pray to the angels, you know, to protect us. And I've actually got caught angelic voices like I experienced on my investigation or on my near-death experience. I actually was able to capture them. And I actually have one picture, I think I posted it on my social media, where when I was investigating one house outside in the yard, there does the spirits that I captured, they don't look like spirits. They look more like angels. And
gotcha.
So, I mean, you know, and they were very loud and clear. Yes, we were here. There are a lot of, you know, they, you know, but they didn't really communicate just to let me know they're there. But there was a spirit that was in there. There's a lot. There's so many ghosts in this house. But this one particular lady, she was so friendly, and the house was for sale, and she kept asking me to buy it. And she's literally, when I'm trying to capture, you know, EVPs and stuff like that, she's like showing me, look how these windows open. It's like, she's a real estate agent, except she was dressed in a very Victorian dress. And I know the pictures of her that I took came out extremely clear, as if she was actually posing for them.
Gotcha.
It was actually a really neat person. I liked her.
Yeah. What was the worst, the most scary? So obviously you probably are not afraid to go into these investigations. Like maybe folks that probably don't have go into these investigations. What was the worst experience for you when you've gone into an investigation, the craziest or worst experience?
I had to do one investigation. Teenage girl using a Ouija board opened up a portal. Now, fortunately, there were a lot of little kids in the house. So fortunately, there were a lot of good spirits, like a grandmother and stuff. And like I was like, okay, there's this lady here that's protecting your daughter. I described her, and the woman's like, oh my God, that's her mom, because she came out very clear. This was a demonic haunting, though. That's why there were so many ghosts there. They were trying to protect the children. And they tried, demons tried to like kind of come across as something that would scare, you know, whoever is haunting in the house. And you would see images like in the walls and stuff. And there was this one point where we were going into the shower, and I had another investigator with me that was quite strong. And he kind of was almost like a bear with like pointed ears, and which frightened the other, at least the psychic that was with me. But I found him comical looking. Like he was just, I was like, wow. I'm like, are you seriously trying to scare me looking like this? You look like an idiot. And so later we did this prayer circle, and we had this very, she was very raw. She was filming, doing, because we tried to film everything, because just to see what we could capture. And we were doing a prayer circle around us, and we were holding hands. And you can't break the circle when you're doing this. And I felt, and it happened to her, really frightened her, but it was frightened to me, these somebody trying to break her arms apart, and on my wrist, like I could see these claw marks in my wrist.
Wow.
He was actually, it wasn't like he was just trying to pull my our hands apart like this. It had clawed into me like this, and I could look down and I could see where it was starting to bleed and stuff like that. And I was like, to the girl next to us, Lena, and she was like, I mean, she was poor girl. I don't think she ever did another investigation. She was absolutely terrified and I hung on her hand. I was like, do not let him break us. Do not let him break us. There's kids in here. Do not let him break us. But it was very frightening just because he was trying so hard to break us apart. And, you know, and I'm sure, I'm sure I pissed it off, but I mean, it was. And that was a really scary situation. And I know that they had some problems. We actually had to go out to that location a couple of times and, you know, and cleanse it. But we couldn't, we wanted to make sure that the demon, you know, this was one of the few demonic, one out of the three demonic hauntings that we went on. And we had to make sure that they were gone because, see, these ghosts that we were seeing, they were relatives of, and they were protecting the children from this evil entity. One thing, though, that was sad was, like, shortly after I started getting really sick, because they do have the ability to make you sick, and I ended up in the hospital for over a month with pancreatitis.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead.
What they'll do is, if they can, they will attack the weakest part of your body, and I happen to be a diabetic, and so what they did was they went for the pancreas. If, you know, it was, they were going after somebody else, they may go to the heart or just whatever that weak part of your body is that they know that they can get you.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Well, yeah, that would definitely sound very creepy or scary if someone, if you feel the clenching on your arm. I mean, yeah, that's so real. Like I said, I mean, these things are so surreal. I mean, like the exorcism, like I said, was, you know, obviously it's based off of a true story or a true event. But I mean, it's surreal because it feels like something like that could happen to someone. Like something can take over someone. So yeah, it's just scary. And that's probably what makes that movie so, not so much the scariness, it's just the scariness of the idea of it, that someone could literally take over their body like that.
Well, I know that at that time when that movie came out, the Catholic Church, who did the exorcism, not having to be Catholic, they had, like, all over the world, they had only 26 people that were actually certified and trained to do exorcisms. Mm-hmm. After that movie came out, the number went up to 119 because they had to train more people because they had so many people thinking. Now, a lot of times they thought it was their teenage kids. And this was also a time, even though it wasn't that long ago, they didn't know that much about bipolar, hormonal changes, sure, and things like that. So just like I may go out and somebody wants me to find a ghost and I can't find a ghost, they may go out and do an investigation and, they're not necessarily possessed. There's something else going on. And that's something that you do have to check, is you have to, okay, where they are mentally, what trauma has happened to them, what could trigger this. And so there's all of these different factors to go in. I know that I will often get people will email me, especially if they're local, and they're like, I want to be a paranormal investigator. Well, you just don't go out there and start waving a, you know, a tape recorder. There's a little bit more to it. And you got to be sensitive and curious to what's going on with that family, because a lot of times there's different moving parts and a spirit will follow you. Mm-hmm. I've had spirits follow me home, you know, and I've had to tell them, okay, you need to go now. Now, I mean, I did have one guy that was very materialistic and he kept showing up in my EVPs and he was following me around. But I was in a bad situation, in a bad work situation. And this guy, I guess, you know, he kept telling me about Hamburger Hill and stuff like that. So I guess he was in the military and he felt a need to protect me. Again, he meant no harm. Mm-hmm. He just had nothing better to do. So I think I'll follow this lady around.
Right. Well, maybe you just thought you were attractive and just wanted to hang out with you, you know.
Well, I will tell you, I had actually recorded my boss having a conversation because I was really paranoid with him. And then I went back to read the EVPs because I kept thinking, hearing things in my head. Because a lot of times when you can hear spirits, you don't necessarily hear them out there in your head. Yeah. And it was very affirming because he told me stuff. He's like, he's lying. He's like, you know, this guy would kick a bunny if he could. And I asked, like, do you have any of these files? He said no. And the guy was like, it's in his desk. and told me exactly where it was. And so his supervisor was asking me, because he knew that this person was up to no good, and asking me stuff. So I gave him the information, and everything turned out to be correct. And they're like, then the guy was afraid of me because he was like, how do you know this stuff? What's going on? And I wouldn't tell him. Because if I said, oh, a ghost helped me out, then he would totally think I was insane.
Sure.
But I mean, but it was, you know, it was like really funny. And I'm like, dude, where were you when I was trying to pass statistics in college?
Yeah, no kidding, right?
Yeah.
Here's the answer sheet to this upcoming quiz, right? Oh wow, yeah, that's funny. I mean,
yeah, and he was a good guy. He was a really good guy. I've gone out when I train people to do investigations and stuff. A lot of times we go to cemeteries where we know that they like to talk a lot, and there's a few. And I know there's one cemetery they never shut up, and like I'll get things just like, I just love those shoes, you know, or you know, you can always tell the time period where they're from by the way that. You know, they'll talk like this, you're a handsome woman.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, well, who says that now? And my son was on that investigation. He's like, who says that now? And I was like, this was something that they would have said in the 20s and 30s.
Right. Yeah, I don't think I've referred to a woman as a handsome woman.
It's very, very, very old school.
Yeah.
And so you can, you know, you can tell the time period of them as well. You can also... you know, their accents come out.
Yeah.
And a lot of times my son and me once I like to go to the Galveston Cemetery because it's so much full of history.
Yeah.
And they'll tell you their story. Like there's this one doctor, he was like, and I guess there was some sort of plague or something that went through, and he was so upset. He's like, all of my patients died. Mm-hmm. And you know, and there's this grave right behind a very strong Irish accent. Two ladies, no, we didn't die, we drowned. My son kind of like, he gets a kick out of that, especially when he was little, because there was a ghost that would follow him around.
Mm-hmm.
And so he, at first it kind of creeped him out, and then he's like, Mom, he's actually kind of a nice kid.
Mm-hmm. So your son sees the ghost too?
He does, not as often, but he hears them, he's very sensitive to them.
Okay.
And if they want him to see him,
mm-hmm.
see them, they will. I know there's a particular really haunted location that we go to that's not too far from here. It's a great place to get ghost pictures and stuff. And ever since we started going there, this little girl will find him and he sees her. And I don't always see her, he's like right there. But the problem is she messes with things. And I remember the first time I encountered her, I was wearing a long skirt. She was pulling my skirt. I sat on a bench. She was I would be sitting there and you would see my hair kind of going like this. And I'm like, okay, we've got some poltergeist action going on. But again, very harmless, very sweet. In fact, I think I have a picture, or I did have a picture of her on my website. I don't know if I still have that picture there. But because I have a really cute picture of her just peeking through the window, you know, looking. And she means no harm. She's just there. She wants to play. My son, I know, especially has difficulties, like, well, why would a child hang out here? Why won't they just move on? Well, in this particular case, it's because her mom's still on the property.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, she's still haunting the property. I've got quite a few pictures of her, too.
Got
Very
it.
Very haunted woman.
Nice. So you mentioned before you can't just decide you want to become a paranormal investigator, right? You can't just walk into it just because you feel like it. So is there places or people that basically help out people that want to get into this?
What happened with me was I had met somebody who realized that I had some abilities,
mm-hmm.
and she set me up with this man by the name of Richard Smith, who did paranormal investigations for many, many, many years, who actually trained me.
Mm-hmm.
And because you have to be really careful, because when you're interviewing, is you've got to be compassionate. You've got to really treat these people, the spirits, with as much respect as you would treat the person. Mm-hmm. That's why when I say I see these shows and I see these, you know, these so-called investigators yelling at them and telling them to show themselves, you're just asking for trouble there. You don't talk to people like that. I think if anybody has a strong interest, they can do it. It can be very tedious. Going through EVP footage can be a very daunting task. What I always recommend is, you know, don't take long, long pieces of EVP. Do very short pieces of EVP, because sometimes you do that. Like sometimes the whispers will be so low that you will actually that you can actually delete something, not realizing that there's something is there. But you also, you can, if you have the proper equipment, you can like see a pattern and you eventually start to learn where there's going to be speaking and stuff too. And the more that you're into it, whether you're sensitive or not, the more sensitive that you are going to be aware, okay, there is something here.
Got it. You're more alert.
And, yeah, you become more alert without even realizing it. And if you think about it, if you're on a ghost tour or going into a doing a tour of a house that you know that's haunted, you're automatically going to be alert for those inflections in temperature or things that aren't so right. You might, you know, some people, they do will hear a whisper behind their, you know, behind their ear. Some people not, but it's just because they're not in tune to it. The more you know about it and the more you do it, the more in tune that you get to it.
Yeah. And on those demonic experiences you had, was there any crazy weather change, climate change, like the air got cold or got windier or anything like that?
In the house, but there's always a little bit of fluctuation in temperature when you have when you're dealing with a spirit or an entity. I haven't necessarily. You can pick up a lot of EVPs with thunder and lightning, but it's not there. That's not what's bringing them there. They're already there. It's just in order to get a strong EVP, you always have to have some white noise background that they can use as far as energy, especially if it's a very weak spirit. Like, so for example, if you see a true investigator, maybe they're investigating outside, they're shuffling their feet on the grass to create that friction that they could possibly use. Or maybe they'll like use the air conditioning. They love fans because they can use the energy from the fans to help with their voices. Mm-hmm. Interesting enough though, is as technology has advanced, sometimes they'll use technology. I had a situation where a good friend of mine had died. And I'm reading in my book, and I knew he, because he'd come and visit me in a dream, so I knew he wanted to talk. And then I hear his voice say, "The dogs are out." And I had my phone sitting up, and it was almost like Siri was saying it. Like Siri picked up on it. And I ran outside, and of course the dogs were out. Once I got the dogs in, and then of course there's a voice, "Told ya." And then one of the things he said, because he was a teacher, and they were really big on us incorporating technology into all of our lessons. And he hated doing that because it was very, very old school. And every time he'd come, he'd be like, "Damn technology, gets me every time, damn technology." And it was so funny because I walked back in there into my room after I put the dogs up, and I was like, "Keith, is that you?" And sure enough, over the phone, "Damn technology."
Yeah, boy. That's so interesting that not only are we using technology to our advantage, so are the spirits. So
absolutely. Yeah. Anything that they can use, yeah. You know, absolutely.
Yeah.
But then again, you've also got the judgmental aspects. Some of them might be afraid of it. You know, yeah. I mean, even if you think back into old Poltergeist, in the movie Poltergeist, Carol Ann hears the spirits through the television.
Right.
Because of the white noise.
Right, right. And obviously somebody like Ted Kaczynski, the Unabomber, didn't like too much the technology. So.
No, not at all.
But anyway, so yeah, Gene, I mean, listen, this has been a very, very interesting conversation we've had today. This is just fascinating to me. You know, it's just not something you talk about with people all the time. So that, I guess that's what also makes it fascinating. So as far as your book goes, obviously you released it, your sequel there. You don't have any plans right now to write any new books at this point, correct?
At this point, I'm currently in the process, and I fell a little bit high behind after my husband's death, but I'm in the process of writing a book called Under the Tower Deep, and it's in the early processes. And there is spirituality and ghosts, but it's evolved around a family of witches that they all have like special power. So it's being told, narrated by a 92-year-old woman who's going back and talking about her abusive father and how she learned about earth magic. And so it's in the early process stages of it. So in fact, right now, I think when I last started typing, it was in 1941.
All right.
So, but it takes place near, and I visit these places that I go to so I can learn the geography, and I interview and I talk to people. And this particular one does happen to take place by the Sabine River, by Elbow's Bayou, where there's a lot of gators and snakes and every tree that you can possibly imagine. Because as fantasy as it may sound, I also have found that people like to read about things that they recognize. I mean, my favorite part of Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil was the fact that I went to Savannah, I knew all of these places, and so.
Like my books, my books are, obviously, fictional, but at the same time, I try to like imp put things in there where people could like either relate to the story somehow or some way, whether it was, relaying music or whatever. So I think, yeah, people, you're right. People probably appreciate, even if it is a fantasy or a made up story, but if they could just like picture something that they're familiar with, then that really make, hits home with them. So.
It can bring in a new brand of readers too, because my book, The 13th Hour, she actually bounces through time by the 13th hour, which is, conducive with the time change. That lost hour we gain or lose. And she goes to different time periods where she run across different types and odd different types of serial killers. All of those serial killers existed. Like there's this one where she's in Chicago. And she is Polish, and she's running this speakeasy and this brothel. But there's an upstairs neighbor who she was a psychic, and all the women would come to find out what's going on with their husbands, and she would predict their death and then go kill them so they can collect the life insurance. That really happened. The woman wasn't psychic at all. She was a serial killer. The first serial killer in Massachusetts that was considered a woman, or that was a woman, she really did exist. So I bring in like some real actual characters. In fact, one of my releases, the Pied Piper's Prince, aka the Candyman, he was the person that was first ever coined a serial killer here in Houston, Texas. In 1973, he was shot and killed by his two teenage accomplices because he would use teenagers to lure in the boys that he would rape, torture, and kill. And even though I've wrapped the house, in fact, they just recently bulldozed down the house, but I wrap fiction around there. It actually takes place in that house that did exist.
Wow. The
And
Candyman, that was made a movie, right?
This one, there was two Candymans. There was one, and of course, from Houston. There was the Candyman that tainted Halloween candy. But the reason why Dean Corll was considered the Candyman was before he worked for HLP, he actually ran his mother's candy factory in the Heights in Texas. And the way he would lure kids in is he would give them free candy. And you bring them in and, gain their trust, kind of groom them. And eventually he started bringing them home and he was torturing and murdering them. And so, but he was often known as the Candyman, and his story is absolutely horrendous. And he's actually buried in a graveyard that's right down the street from my house. So I flip it off every time I go by.
So while I was growing up and hearing don't go getting Halloween candy and eating it, probably
Yes.
because of them.
Well, yeah, because the guy in Deer Park, what it was he wanted to kill his own child. So he tainted all these other candies so all these other kids would get it as well. And, I lived in Springfield spring at the time. Deer Park is just a stone's throw from where I'm at now. But anywhere, especially in Texas, Halloween was destroyed. You either went to the school and went to their, that's when they started school carnivals, or we didn't go trick-or-treating unless it was people that we know. Mm-hmm. And the sad thing is I remember saying this, and this, of course, before I lived so close to it, you know, telling my parents, well, somebody knew that those kids that he poisoned.
Yeah.
You know, you can't even trust people that you know.
Right.
And, you know, I was very young when that happened. And it, for many years, it destroyed Halloween.
Yeah.
And even now, I don't know about in other states, but in Texas, like hospitals will set up their x-ray machine so that you can run x-rays through it. Police officers will offer to go through the candy and stuff like that. And so, I mean, it destroyed, it destroyed. And I remember it did make national news.
Yeah. Yeah. Halloween was never special to me because of all these scary stories. It's just like, I didn't want to go out and trick or treat. I mean, why?
Yeah.
I don't want to collect anything. So, I mean, it's cute to see the kids in costumes and all that. So, but I mean, for me,
oh, yeah.
Yeah. But so, all right. Well, anyway, Gina, listen, it's been great having you here. Where can the audience get your book or maybe contact you in case they have an investigative paranormal investigation for you?
They can go to my website, ginalynelle.com, GINALYNELLE.com. They can go through the websites. There are links to my books. There's also book trailers available if they want to look at the trailers. And there is a contact form if they want to contact me, ask me any questions. I usually get back within, you know, 24 to 72 hours, to answer their questions and, anything that they want to know, I'm willing to respond to.
Sounds great. And of course, I'm going to have all of these links on the video description below. And for the folks out there, here, if you haven't subscribed yet, smack those buttons, subscribe and like. And so that way we can have more guests such as Gina as well come on. And maybe even Gina might come back later on when she releases another book and
absolutely.
have another discussion. Because, you know, like I said, it's been fun talking to you. And, you know, good luck with everything. Thank you again. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
So, if you are connected on my social media sites, contact me directly to make an appearance on the MPP Power Hour. Hurry while there are still spots available. Don't forget to smack those buttons to subscribe and like my video. Thank you for watching.